Coming to you live from Miami, on the strip site. Great Beth Kenesha, Rabbi Amale, Shmele Wanin.
You're done,
it is? Okay, yeah, the Hazakah. Let me just get myself set up over here with the guy on the hard channel. We have to consult with him a lot today. Gemara Megillah Daf Yudalit Maseches been dedicated by our good friend Mr. Norman Nassim Jamal in honor of my parents. Shachat Baruch Hu Yibarech Otam Bebriut Etana Benachat Mikol Yiladim Nechadim Amen Ken Yiratzon. We are on today's Daf Yudalit and we're going to start on the bottom of Yud Gimal Amud Bet, and we start Vayomer HaMelech LeHaman. הכסף נתון נח, והעם לעשות בו כתוב בעיניך. So let's go back to the story over here in Megillat Esther. We have over here where Haman offered the king to pay for the extermination of the Jewish people. It cost money to exterminate people. So therefore, Hashverosh was more than glad to pay the bill himself. הכסף נתון נח. He said, the money is given to you, just make sure you kill every single Jew. So we learn over here that the Ahasuerus was no less of an anti-Semite than Haman. They both had the same nefarious intentions. And the Gemara comes along and gives one of the famous Mishalim, Mashal the Ahasuerus ve Haman, the parable to these two villains is Lema Adabar Dome. What is it analogous to? The Shnei Bene Adam, they had one of the fellows had a mound of dirt, which is obviously not desirable, and he had it in his field. And another one had a furrow, a hole. The guy with the hole says, I wish this guy will sell me. I'll pay for the dirt in order that I could fill up my hole. Ba'alatel Amar, the guy with the dirt says, Mi yitinli harit zeh bedamim, which means, who will give me, I'll pay for the harits. I need this coal. Liyamim, the davigu zeh etzel zeh. Days later, they both met. Amalu bal harits. So the bal harits tells the ba'alatel, this is the mashal to Haman. Haman is the bal harits. He's the one with the hole. And he says he's willing to pay in order to get the tail to put it in his hole. The ba'al ha-tail, mechor li tilach, sell it to me. Amar lo, so Ahasuerosh in this example would be, tol ota bechinam, take it for free, vehalvai, which means it's on me. I'll take care of the expenses. He can't wait to get rid of it, which means more than Haman wanted to get rid of the Jews, Ahasuerosh wanted to get rid of the Jews as well. That's the opinion of who Amar Lo Maharsha says Tol Bechinam Bidima et the Ahasuerosh the Baal Tel Shehu Bidemyon Yisrael. Now who's the tail? The tail is the Jewish people. That's the mound of dirt is the Jewish people. So therefore, each one wants to get rid of the dirt. And Ahasuerosh clearly was part of it. And therefore, and the Gemara says both of them anti-Semitic. Vayasar ha-melech et tabato. At that point, it says the king took off his ring and he gives it to Haman. And once the Haman has the ring, so that gives him carte blanche in order to do whatever he wants. The Gemara says that one move did more to bring the Jewish people closer to God than what 48 prophets over the generations did by rebuking. You know, rebuking is just words. But when they saw the actual, Haman walking now with this ring that they know he could use this ring against the Jewish people, signing documents like he would do, so that already brought them much closer to Kadosh Baruch Hu. Amar Rabbi Abba Bar Kahana, Gedola Hasarat Taba'at Yoter Marba'im Ushmona Nebi'im, did more than the 48 male prophets, v'sheva nebiot, the 7 female prophets, shetnabeu lahem the Israel, shekulam lo choziram lemutav. All the prophets, they pontificated, they gave sermons, they gave dirashot, but it fell mostly on deaf ears. ואילו הסרת טבעת, יחזירם למותר. But taking off the ring, that actually brought them למותב. The Maharsha points out and says, תלה גזירת המלך בסרת טבעת, והעם לעשות בו כתוב בעיניך. Because if you remember, with the ring came instructions. והעם לעשות בו כתוב בעיניך. Do as you wish with the nation. And it says in the Midrash, Ahasuerus היה שונא ישראל ביותר. Normally, when you give somebody a expensive item, don't you take a collateral for it? He didn't even ask Haman for a collateral. He gave him his ring, and he told him, I trust you to do so. Therefore, you see how much hatred he had over here. Now, based on this Gemara, we can answer a famous question that's written in Masechet Gittin. Second Gittin says, "Mebnei banav shel Haman lemedu Torah bebnei Berak," that Haman had some grandchildren that became converts, and they became great teachers in Bnei Berak, which means Haman has some sort of zechut. Yet at least some of his descendants became Torah leaders, Torah teachers. So the great Rabbi Be'er Yosef, Rabbi Yosef Salant, in Parashat Korach, he says, "What do you mean? What zechut over here does Haman have?" So he says it's based on this Gemara. Because what came from Haman was he caused the Jewish people to make teshuvah. Even though he did not have intention for this, it's obvious that Haman didn't say, how can I bring the people back to teshuvah? Let me scare them. However, en HaKadosh Baruch Hu mekapeach schar kol b'riyah. Borei Olam is very generous. Borei Olam does not hold back the reward from any of his creatures, that even if somebody did something and good came out of it, even though it wasn't his intent, even though it was the opposite intent, he was trying to, but something good came out of him, Borei Olam rewards him for that. So the reward of this Gemara was Bnei Banav Shel Haman Lemedu Torah Bnei Berak. That's a good item that nothing goes unpaid. Everything Borei Olam registers, something good came from you, so it'll be it'll be registered in Shamayim as well. Gemara continues and says, "Tanu Rabbanan 48 Nevi'im, the 48 prophets, b'sheva Nevi'ot nedabehu lahem liYisrael." Those were the prophecies that gave prophecy. Ve'lo pichatu ve'lo hotiru al ma shekatu b'Torah. Obviously, they did not add to the mitzvot. Even though you're a prophet, it doesn't give you the license to add any of the mitzvot, nor does it give them the license to subtract from any of the mitzvot. Now, I don't need a Gemara to tell me that. Obviously, if they were legitimate prophets, not going to add or subtract. What it means is they didn't find any allusions in the Torah to give them a hint that maybe a new mitzvah should be added or a mitzvah should be subtracted. However, when it came to Mikram Megillah, they actually found the Mazim in the Torah, and therefore, it allowed them to establish Megillah and Purim. My darosh, Amar b'chaya bar Abin, Amar Rabbi Yosef ben Korcha. Well, they made a what's called a kal b'chomer. What's the kal b'chomer? Uma be'abdut lecherut amrin anshira b'mita lechayim nokol sheken. If we sing the shira of as Yashir Moshe, when we came out of Mitzrayim. When we came out of Mitzrayim, we were coming from slavery to freedom. And that's worthy of a shira. Kol Sheken, in coming out of the story of Purim, we weren't coming out of slavery. We were coming out of death sentence, which is much more severe. L'chaim. Lo Kol Sheken. All the more so, it should warrant a shira. And what's that shira called? Megillat Esther. Megillah is a din of a shira. So that was the dirash that they came along and said, so the Gemara says, wait, if you're comparing it to the Shira of Yitziat Mitzrayim, Hallel Namenema, why don't you say Hallel as well? Don't we say Hallel on Pesach? So they were just like you say Shira on Pesach, as Yashir, we should also say Hallel on Purim. Mm-hmm. Gemara says, wait, slow down. Lefisheen omrim Hallel, we forgot the rule. We do not establish the recitation of Hallel on miracles that take place in Chutz La'aretz. And the story of Purim happened clearly Shushan, and all the other cities that were outside of Israel. He goes, what are you talking about? Yitziat Mitzrayim Denes Shebechutz La'aretz. Where did Pesach happen? Also in Mitzrayim and Chutz La'aretz. Hechi Amninan Shira. So how do you say Shira then? How do you say Hallel? The Gemara says, no, there's a big difference. Kedetanya, ad shelo nichnisu Yisrael, ad shelo nichnisu Yisrael la'aretz, hukshiru kol aratzot lomar shira. Before we entered Eretz Yisrael, then all lands are suitable for miracles to say a shira. And therefore, when we were in Egypt, it was before we actually entered Eretz Yisrael. So therefore, we didn't yet enter, therefore Hallel is in order. Once we entered Eretz Yisrael, even though later we'd be exiled, too late. Once you enter Eretz Yisrael, therefore the story of Purim happens after Galut Babel. That means we were in exile. Therefore, once we were in Israel and left, that's it. There's no Hallel on outside of Israel miracles. Now that's the first derash. So the first derash is that why do we read the Megillah on Purim? Because it's a connection to Yitziat Mitzrayim, and therefore, just like they said a shira me'avdut lechirut, so certainly we should say a shira from mitah lechayim. That's the opinion of who? That's the opinion of the Gemara in the name of Rav Chiya bar Abin, in the name of Rabbi Yoshua ben Korcha. Rav Nachman Amar, Rav Nachman has a different hadush. He says, Kriyata zu halila. He's not bothered by the halil issue. He says you could say halil maybe in Hussaris. That doesn't bother him. But what's the issue? You're saying halil. The Megillah itself is the halil. Interesting. So now we have a new deen that Megillat Esther covers two things. It's a shira, but it also has a deen of Halil. Based on this Gemara, Rav Chida says a big chiddush to Birkei Yosef. He says, let's say somebody is out of town and it's Purim day and he doesn't have a kosher Megillah. He couldn't get a kosher Megillah. There's no minyan in the place. So he's not going to be able to read the Megillah, kedat bechadin. So he says he should read the Halil without a beracha because he has a chayuv of Halil. When he's reading the Megillah, kriyatazu halilah, but if he's not going to read the Megillah, he has an obligation of Halel on him. Of course, without a beracha, because there's different answers over here. He says, lefachot, he should say Halel in order to fulfill his Darav Chida. Rava Amar, Rava comes along and says, Bishlama Hatam, hold it. I understand why you want to say Halel in Mitzrayim, because why? Halilu Avde Adonai, Velo Avde Paro. Beautiful. We're not the slaves of Paro anymore. However, if you know the history, what happened after the miracle of Ahasuerus and Haman? We still were under the thumb of Ahasuerus. Nothing changed. Elahaka, Halilu Avde Adonai, Velo Avde Ahasuerus. You can't say Velo Avde Ahasuerus, Akate Avde Ahasuerus Adam. We were still the slaves of Ahasuerus. Nothing changed, which means in Mitzrayim, at least we got out of the Galut. Over there, we still were in Galut. So what are you saying? How can you say Halil? The Halil is not suitable for the story of Ahasuerus. Rashi comes along and says, Akate Abde Ahasuerus, they only got saved from Mita, but we were still under the sovereignty of Ahasuerus. So the Gemara comes along and says, Ben the Rabba, Ben the Rabban, the Nachman Kasha. Now we're going to ask questions on both opinions, the opinion of Rabba and the opinion of Rab Nachman. The opinion of Rab Nachman was what? Kiriyata zu halila, that the kiriya is considered a halel. And Rabba comes along and says what? That you cannot say the Hallel, because how can you say Halu Avde Hashem? What's the question on both of them? Once they came into Eretz Yisrael, no more Shira. But wait, once they went into exile, they go back to the original status. And once you come into exile, Hallel is back in play. So you could say Hallel in Chutz La'aretz. So therefore, what do you have to come along and say? You could say the Hallel. You could say the Hallel completely. Why? Because after we left Eretz Yisrael into Galut, and now have miracle in Chutz La'aretz, it's permissible to say the Hallel. Vitu, not only that, Vitu, that's it. So that's the question that they have on those opinions. Now the Chavra, Hallel should be suitable to say, because once we came back, once we left Eretz Yisrael and went into Galut, all the places become fit again. Now it should be pointed out, Midrashi ben Rabah damar lahachidu amnina and Hallel, nakati ad hachashos shavu, hala vachi amnina. What's the question on Rabah? Rabah said, I don't agree that you should say Hallel on Purim. Why? Because I'm worried about the fact Akati Avdei Hashverosh. You're still slaves of Hashverosh. But if it wasn't for that reason, he would have no problem to say the Hallel on Purim. It's a technical reason, he said. Read Rashi. Ben Rav Nachman Damar Kiryat Megillah Bimkom Hallel. Or Rav Nachman's opinion was what? You are saying Hallel on Purim. How are we saying Hallel on Purim? Because Kriyat Azu Halila. So therefore, the Gemara is again, I'm meaning the first line. The first line comes along and says, Ben Rabba, Ben Rahman, Kashya. Natanya, because it says, Vishenichnesu la Ares, Lo Uksheru kola Aratzot, Lomar Shina. So therefore, what? That's the question. How can you say Shina once already? We left Eretz Yisrael. The Gemara answers, "Kevan shegalu hazru lechshiran arishon." That once we went into exile, now Chutz La'aretz takes its original position. If we can't say Hallel, what problem? So let's just review it because I read it wrong the first time. Which means the Gemara now saying that ultimately there's no problem to say Hallel in Chutz La'aretz. When can't you say Hallel in Chutz La'aretz? When you're in Eretz Yisrael. And the miracle happens in Chutz La'aretz, you cannot. When it's Israel, Chutz La'aretz has no standing. But once you went into exile, now Hazul Eteram Arishom, so therefore, there's no problem to say Hallel on this Purim. So therefore, the first Rabbi Rav Nachman says, what? We are saying Hallel. What's the Hallel? Kriyatazu Alila. And what does Rabbi say? I also have no problem to say Hallel. It's just you have a technical problem. What are you going to say? Hallelu Abde Hashem, Velo Abde Hashverosh, Akate Abde Hashverosh Adan. But if it wasn't for that problem, I also have no issue to say Hallel on a Nes that happened Bechutz La'aretz. Based on this, we have over here an interesting Maharsha that points out that Kriyatazu Halila, that the Kriya is the Hallel. Now we know that on Pesach, how many times do we say Hallel? Twice. We say it at night and we say it in the day. So from here, the Maharsha says we can bring a proof why you have to read the Megillah Balayla Ubayom. Because since it's following Hallel, and since we made the Kal Vachomer from Pesach, Uma Pesach Omrim et Hallel Pa'amayim, Af Megillat Esther, we have an ayah why you have to say it twice, one Balayla and one Bayom. Because again, we have the Kal Vachomer, Uma, Me'abdut Lechirut, Me'mita La'ayim L'kot Sheken. So if from Abdut Lechirut, you say it twice. Kot Sheken, Me'mita La'ayim, you should say it twice as well. A beautiful Maharsha. Now, it should just be pointed out, Abotai, you must read the top Rashi, Chutz Mikra Megillah, which is there was no more additions from the prophets except Mikra Megillah. She has a problem. Im Tomar Ner Hanukkah. What are you talking about? We have Ner Hanukkah. That's another addition that they added. Kevar Pasku HaNevi'im. So that wasn't the Takana from Nevi'im. Maharsha understands this Rashi to mean that was a Takana from Hachamim. Now, what do you mean? Hachamim can make Takanot? If Nevi'im cannot make Takanot, how can Hachamim make Takanot? Explanation is they can't add. Nobody can add. It means that the Hachamim found a remez in the Torah for Hanukkah as well. And therefore, when the rabbis added these new mitzvot, they didn't just say, okay, let's take a vote, we're making a new holiday. They opened up the Torah and they had to find somewhere in the Torah itself that gives a remez in order for them to establish it. So Maharsha says, when it came to Megillah, who was able to find the remez? Nevi'im. Because in Mordechai's time, there were still prophets. He was a prophet, like we're going to learn now. Mashiach and then Hanukkah, who found the illusion? Hakamim. But it's okay, they're allowed to find it. That's the way the Maharsha explains. Okay, Rabotai, we continue. Vetuleka, new question. You just told me, how many Nevi'im do we have? 48. Ah, that's it. There's only 48 prophets. The Gemara is going to say that actually we have over a million. This is talking about the tzaddik called Elkanah, the father of Shemuel. And it tells us where he lived. He lived in Ramataim Sofim. Now, he really didn't live in Ramataim. He lived in Ramah. But over here, it's telling us he lived in Ramataim. So therefore, the Gemara finds this word Ramataim strange. He didn't live in two places. Ramataim is plural. He lived in Ramah. So the Gemara says, there's a derash over here. Echad mimataim sofim shenetnabeu lahem Yisrael. Ramataim, we doreshit that what? One of 200 prophets of his time. In his time, there was Ramataim. It's like Mataim. And the Resh is also 200. Ramataim. So it's Resh, Mataim. So therefore, that's Maharsha said. So just in Elkanah's generation alone, there was 200 prophets. Gemara said, no. Meva tuvahav. There was many prophets. We know that. Kedetanya, harbe nevi'im amdu lahem Yisrael, kiflaim ki yotzei Mitzrayim. How many Jews between 20 and 60 came out of Mitzrayim? 600,000. And it says the prophets were double that. So that's 1.2 million prophets. As a matter of fact, they used to have schools in the olden days where the students should go and learn to become a prophet, just like you learn to become a scribe or you learn to become a hazan. He went to yeshivot, they were called B'nei HaNevi'im. The schools, the students of the Nevi'im, they taught you, it's a skill to become a prophet. So there was hundreds of thousands, there was millions of them. Ela nebu'a shutzlecha ledorot nechteba. Vishnotzlecha lo nechteba. Which you can be a prophet, but you're not relevant. Which means your prophecies are not written down for the dorot, for the generations. So those prophets that had prophecy, personal stuff, a million of them. Mashiach and the prophets that have their words written down for the generations, there's only 48 of those. Now, the Rashi over here actually comes along and lists the 48 Nevi'im. It's kedai to go through it just to remind ourselves who are the 48. Lilmod Teshuvah or Hora'ah. The purpose of the prophets is either to bring the people back to Teshuvah or to teach them an instruction. Okay, Rabotai. Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, Moshe, Aharon, Yehoshua, Pinehas. Okay, he quotes a pasuk. We are Malak Hashem and Agilgal, El Abuchim, Ze Pinehas. We have Uisha Elohim, El Eli, Ze Elkana. Now he continues. Eli, the Akohen, Shemuel, Gad, Natan, David, Shlomo, Ido. Okay, quotes a pasuk. Michayu ben Yimla, that's the terms of Ahab, Ovadia, Achya Shiloni, Yehu ben Hanani, that's the terms of Asa, Azaria ben Oded, Haziel Halevi, Eliezer ben Dodom Morasha, Kulam Yehoshaphat, the times of Yerovam, you had Yoash, Shea, sorry, in the times of Yerovam ben Yoash, you had two prophets, Hosea and Amos. Ubimei Yotam, who did you have? Micha Amorashti. In the time of Amatsya, you had Amots. Like we saw in the prescription, you have Eliyahu, of course. Eliyahu and Nabi. Elisha, Yonah ben Amitai. Yeshaya, which is the time of Menashe, you had who? Yoel, Nahum, Habakkuk. In the times of Yoshiah, you had Sefaniah. And Uriah Mikriyat Ya'arim, Yirmiyah, and Yehezkel, you had his time, you had Daniel. And then you had also Baruch, Niriya, Siriya, Mahsiya, Haggai, Zecharia, Malachi, Mordechai, Belshan, that's our tzaddik. And there you go, Rabotai.
They don't see Daniel here.
But they may see too.
Azago Baruch finished the Rashi, and he says at the end, Shenayim lo yadati. There's two more that I don't know. And if you look at the note over here, he says, Shenayim lo yadati, Shenayim Hanani ve'Oded. So if you look at the Haggahot Agra, he adds the two prophets that Rashi is missing. Okay, Rabotai, we continue. Shmuel. Yes, we live the Gilgulim, but they lived as separate humans. So therefore, in humans, we count them as two. Correct. Even though in the Shamot, they would maybe had the same neshama. Sheila Tova. Rabbi Shmuel ben Nachmani Amar, Adam Haba Mishter Ramot, Shesofot, Zo Etzu. Back to the story of Elkanah. Mazer Matayim Sofim. He came from a place where two mountains see each other. Because the mountain is over here and the mountain is over there. So Ramatayim Sofim, the mountains see each other. Of course, he didn't live in both of them. He lived in one of them. But he lived in a place over there between the two mountains that see each other. That's the way he lives. Now the Gemara comes along and says, Marsha just points out, Abotai, that although we said that there's 200 prophets in Elkanah's time, but that doesn't argue what we said above. In the time of Yetziat Mitzrayim, there was 1.2 million. But just in Elkanah's time, there was 200. It's two different inyanim. Okay, Rabotai. Now the Gemara comes along and says, Rab Hanin Amar Adam Haba Mebnei Adam She'omdim Berumo Shel Olam. Oh, who is Elkanah? He comes from Rabatayim. He comes from descendants. He comes from ancestors that were umdim birumo shel olam, that stood in the high places. Who are these people that came from high places? Maninu benekorach, nichtiv nekorach lo metu. Remember what happened when the sinkhole opened up? Everybody went down, and then all of a sudden a ledge came out of the betroshel gehinam, and what did benekorach do? They made teshuvah and they jumped on the ledge. So indeed, the umdim berumo shel olam, they stood in a high place. So that na is miramatayim sofim. Uba me'elu shayu umdim berumo. Me'elu shayu umdim berumo. Bnei Korach. That's exactly what happened. Tana mishum rabenu. Like we learned, makom nitbatzel lahem begehinam. A little ledge came out of the Gehenna, and eventually they were able to escape and come out. Now we discuss the seven prophetesses. Sheva Nevi'ot, Manihu, who are they? Interesting, the Gemara doesn't tell us the 48, but the Gemara will tell us the seven. I don't know why the Gemara doesn't want to tell us the 48. Okay, doesn't take too much time, I guess. Sarah, Miriam, Deborah, Hannah, Abigail, Hulda, Esther. There was it. Now we get to the proofs. Sarah, Dichtib, Avi Milka, Avi Yiska. Now, Yiska is another name for Sarah Emin. Why did they call her Yiska? The Amar Bietzchak, Yiska, Zu, Sarah. The Nama Nikra Shema Yiska, Shesachta Beruah HaKodesh. That she had on her divine providence, she had on her Ruach HaKodesh, she was hovered like a sukkah, like tzkak was over her. Shene emar, kol asher tovar elecha sara, shema bekola. How do we know? Because Avraham is also a prophet. And what did God say to Avraham?
Listen to her.
Exactly, that whatever she comes along and says, shema bekola. And as she, the Maharsha points out, mazeh lekola, not lekola, lekol Ruach HaKodesh Sheba. She has Ruach HaKodesh coming out of her mouth, and therefore, listen to what she has to say. Now, Bekola is extra, because the Pasukah said, Kol Asher Tomar Elecha Sara Shema. So, what is Bekola? So from here, the Gemara Doresh, Yesh Mashu Bekola. She doesn't have Stam Kola. What's in her Kola? Hazak Baruch, Ruach HaKodesh. So therefore the key word over here is Bekola. Sheyesh Bekola Mashu Hashuv Veze Prophecy. Rabotai, we continue. Davar Acher Yiska Shakol Sochin BeYofya. Because she was very beautiful, and everybody would bask to look at her beauty. Miriam, how do we know Miriam was a prophet? That's an easy one. Dichtiv, but the cup Miriam and Nevi'ah. Miriam and Nevi'ah. The pasuk says it. Miriam and Nevi'ah. Achot Aharon. The Gemara says Achot Aharon, but Achot Moshe. Why is it only called the sister of Aharon? She was also the sister of Moshe. Amar of Nachman, Amar Rab. Shaita mitnabe'ah kishihi Achot Aharon. She was still giving prophecy when she was only the sister of Aharon before Moshe was born. So she was in Nevi'ah kishiaita Achot Aharon before she became the sister of Moshe. She was young. Yeah, in those days they were mature. The Amra beomeret. Why should he tell her father? Atida imi sheteled ben sheyoshiat Yisrael. She had a prophecy. My mother is going to give birth to the Redeemer of Israel. The Shah Shinolad when Moshe Rabbeinu was born, the whole house was filled with light because they saw the prophecy of Miriam came true. The Moshe Rabbeinu. Amad Abiyah ben Ashka'arosha. Amram went and kissed Miriam on her forehead. Your prophetess, it came true because they saw the light of Moshe Rabbeinu. But then the Gezerah Paro came. This week's parasha, and now Moshe Rabbeinu was thrown into the or. Amram went and hit him in the head. What happened to your prophecy? Miriam stood on the foot of the Yamsuf, to know what? She knew a prophecy is going to come true. So she wanted to see the Hashkaha, how a prophecy is going to materialize. So therefore, she stood, and sure enough, she saw the story of Batya taking the Teva. Devora dichtiv, udvora isha nevi'ah. Devora, it says clearly, isha nevi'ah, eshet lapidot. She was the wife of lapidot. Who is lapidot? My eshet lapidot, shaita ose petilot lemikdash. Husband had a minhag. He would make wicks for the Bet HaMikdash. And therefore, they nicknamed them lapidot. That's the way they refer to him. Become a ketuvim yehesa isha achar isha kegon ya'el eshet hever akeni. Sometimes they refer to the lady or the husband. They refer to him who is married to. So it says ya'el. Who's ya'el? Eshet hever akeni. She's the wife of hever akeni. Or b'shem eshet shaul. The wife of shaul is who? Achinoam. She'ish mefursam. When the husband is famous, so they come along and say, who's this lady? Oh, that's the wife of this famous guy. We don't know who Lapidot is, by the way. When you come along and you tell me that you have Devorah, oh, you know what Devorah is? Husband is Lapidot. Who's Lapidot? We don't know. We know Devorah more than we know Lapidot. Devorah is more famous than Lapidot. So therefore, we learn that it's really not a husband. Ela Lapidot was referring to what Devorah herself did. Shehaita osa pitilot lamikdash. Not her husband. We don't know who her husband is. When it says Eshet Lapidot is referring to what Devorah did. She used to have a custom to make wicks. And therefore, midah keneged midah. She brought light to the Bet HaMikdash. And therefore, Borei Olam gave her the light of prophecy and the light of Torah to judge the Jewish people. That's Eshet. Of course, she was a Shofet. Slow down. You're running my train. Where are you going? You're running my train. Go down over there. What do you want to do over here? You have go to the movies now? Where you go? So now the pasuk comes along and says, "Vehi yoshevet tachat tomer." It says, "Where would she sit?" She was sat under a palm tree. This is Nogea in Miami over here. Rabotai, in Yaneda Yoma. Vehi yoshevet tachat tomer. Now, why would she be sitting? First of all, who cares what type of tree she was sitting under? So the Gemara says, "Maishe na tachat tomer. What do I care if it's a tomer or if it's a sycamore tree or if it's another type?" Amar Rabbi Shimon ben Abi Shalom, Shum Yehud. Because people would come to her for consultation. She was a shofetet, and she was alone with men. She cannot be alone with men because it's a Yehud problem. Now, other trees, what happens? The leaves go all the way down. Therefore, when you're under the tree, it's Yehud. Mashiach and the palm tree goes up. So therefore, she can sit under the tree and there's no problem. Everybody can see her. So there's no problem of, you know, that's what's coming to tell us that she was tzaddiket. She sat under specifically the tomer tree, so there's no problem of Yehud. Davar acher, ma tamar ze en lo ela lev echad, ap yisrael shemotu ador, lo haya lahem lev echad lavim shel shamayim. The Maharsha explains that most trees, they have sap in the trunk itself, and also in the branches they have sap. But the tomer tree only has sap in one place, in the trunk, but not in the branches. So too, Bnei Israel were like the tomer tree, that their loyalty was only in one place, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and not to anybody else in that generation. So there's a remez of the tomer to the Klal Yisrael's religious status at that time. The Barak continues, Hana, how do you know Hana was a prophetess? Dichtiv, Vatitpalel Hana Batomar. Alas libi Badonai. Rama Karni Badonai. She comes along and mentions that what there's going to be descendants that come out of her, namely Shemuel. And Shemuel is going to appoint kings. He's going to appoint one king with a pach. A pach is a earthenware jug. That king that he appoints with the jug of earthenware is not going to have endurance. Shaul's king did not last. He will appoint another king, namely David, with a horn, a keren, which is strong, like a shofar. That you can't break. His kingdom will stand. And therefore, Hannah saw all this in prophecy. So what did she say? Rama Karni, the one that gets the anointment with keren, with the horn, Rama, will be elevated. Rama Karni, Velo Rama Pachi, but not my Pachi. The one that gets the pach, was what? An earthenware vessel, if you drop it on the floor, what happens? Breaks. So they were temporary. David Ushlomo Shinim Shahu Bekeren. David and Shlomo that got the Mishah Bekeren. Nimshecha Malchutan. Their kingdom endured. Shaul Vihu Shinim Shahu Bepach. Lo Nimshecha Malchutan. Very good. Now, if you look at the Tosfotim over here, first Tosfot says Meshum Yehud. Kishibain Eleha Bene Israel Mishpat. So that's the way we learn. Now look at the next. Dichtiv Vatitpalel Hana Vatomar Alat Libi Bashem. We just proved that Hana was a prophetess. From where? The first Pasuk. Alat Libi Bashem Rama Karni. That means she saw that Shemuel, her son, is going to appoint kings. Tosfot asks. By the way, every Pasuk in that parasha shows us that she's a prophet. Shekol and Nebuah, the whole thing is on what? Sanhedrin, Nebuchadnezzar, Haman. She was prophesizing about many events that didn't happen. So why did the Gemara bring this? The Gemara could have brought any pasuk Tosfot says. Which means it brought you the first pasuk. Ramakani Bashem. Alat Sibi Bashem Ramakani. It could have brought you any pasuk. So why did it bring this one? The first pasuk finished. All Tosfot saying is the whole Perek proves that she was indeed a prophetess. Now we're going to give some derashot on this parasha. What did she say? En kadosh ka Hashem. That nobody like Hashem. Ki en biltecha. Maze en biltecha. Amar Rav Yehuda bar Menashia. Ad terche biltecha. Ela lebalotecha. That you cannot last longer than a Kadosh Baruch Hu. Which means normally when a person creates something, the guy that makes this table, the table will last longer than the guy who made it. That means he will become worn out, but the table that he made stays for longer time. Guy makes, builds a building. Who gets worn out first? The builder. But the building, who made it loud? The Kadosh Baruch Hu is the opposite. In the Balotecha. He creates, but he outlives his creations. His creations become worn out before him. God is not like the human. Exactly. The creations outlive the creator normally. He witnesses the deterioration of his creatures while he's still in his existence. And lebalotecha, that nothing is able to deteriorate you. On the contrary, you deteriorate your creations, and not the opposite. That means God is kayam lanetza. The ensur kenohenu. There's no rock like God. En sayar kenohenu. As en sayar, there's no painter like God. God's the best painter. Sayar. Why? Adam sar tzura al gabe kotel. A guy, let's say, draws a picture on the wall. Benu yakol latil baruah uchama. He cannot put life into that picture, get a mind inside into that picture, and intestines. But in Olam, he makes an image, and then what? He puts a tzura in the image. With a picture. I mean, he puts a picture, then he gives life to the picture.
Rabbi, how do I address the golem?
Well, before we get to the golem, that you can go to Prague for the golem, but now we're going to say the rasha from the that I heard from Ephraim Brim on this Gemara, en sayar kelohen. What does it mean, en sayar kelohen? There's no painter like God. He says a tremendous musab. He said, normally if you have a very, very good painter that can draw, let's say, a picture on the wall of grass, and you see a blue sky and the sun, and he puts it on the wall. If you're far away from the picture, it looks real. You say, wow, this is a, but as you get closer, then you realize that what? That it is indeed fake. This is the nature of the normal human painter. That the further you're away from the picture, the more real it looks. I said, but here, Baruch Hu, amazing thing. He created this world. It's a big picture. A lot of things going on in this world, but it has the opposite effect. Those that are close to Olam Hazeh, that are indulging Olam Hazeh, they think it's real. The closer you are to Olam Hazeh, the more real you think it is. When do you realize that Olam Hazeh is fake? You have to step back. The further you're away from Olam Hazeh, then you realize how fake it is. Therefore, En Sayar Kelohenu. Borei Olam is the reverse effect. Normally, the further you're away from a picture, the more real it looks. Here, the more further you're away from Olam Hazeh, which is God's picture, the more fake it looks. Only those that are in it, they unfortunately think that it is real. Therefore, it's a tremendous reverse effect that Borei Olam has in the way that he creates his world. Now the Gemara continues and talks about an amazing episode in the Nevi'im about Avigai. Abigail was married to a man called Nabal. He was named, whoever named him correctly, because he indeed was Nabalu Nabal Shemo. His name was fit. Vehaya hi rochevet ala hamor. So she was riding on the donkey. Viyoredet baseter ahar. And she came down baseter ahar. As a seter ahar. She was coming down the mountain. There's a seter, the hidden part of the mountain. So Gemara comes along and says, "Baseter ahar min ahar mebeile." And the seter, Amar Abba Bar Shmuel, "Al eske dam Abba min a seteri." Oh, she came down the mountain and she had a question. She had a question regarding something that comes from a hidden place. And that's the blood of Nida that comes from Makom Seter. What was her question? She had a she'ela, like the ladies today have the question on Dam Nida. Who are you going to ask? The tzaddik. Who's the tzaddik? David HaMelech was there. So she took the bedika and she went to David HaMelech and she's going to say, Hakam David, I need a ruling. Is this Dam over here? Tehora or Tebea? Now, first of all, you see how humble David was. David, he doesn't say, I'm the king. You're giving me Dam Nida. Go to the rabbi of the town. What do you mean? The Melech is going to get his hands dirty with blood? If you remember, we learned the Gemara Berachot, that was the greatness of David. That David, it says, Shamelan Afshiki Hasid Ani. I'm a Hasid. What makes him a Hasid? All the kings, they're sitting in their bed, in their silk cloths, having breakfast in bed, and all their kavod. And he says, my hands are dirty with blood. Why? Because it's a zechut. Lehatir isha leba'ala. David HaMelech looked at it as a merit in order to allow a lady to go back to her husband. It's a big zechut. So here is no exception. David HaMelech is going to get a question, but Rabotai, Abigail was not asking David a question in Hilchot Nida. She really was trying to give David a little musar, but in a clever way. Now let's see what happened. That's the seter. Al esker dam abba min haseterim. Natla dam, she took some blood. Ve'etalo. So David tells to her, hey, what does it say? It was nighttime already. Amar la v'chimer in dam balayla. You're not allowed to show the rabbi the blood at night because he needs to look at the natural sunlight in order to see the colors. So, and they didn't have a flashlight. Even if you have flashlight, you should have used it. You can only see dam in the day. So she says, aha, the amra lo, fashot balayla. What happened? Naval, a husband, was considered Moren bin Malchut. He said words against David. He said, today every servant rebels against his master. He's the king. David HaMelech said, Hayam Mita. It was nighttime. So she says to David, hold on, you forgot the halakha. You cannot judge Dine Nefashot Balayla. If you look at the...
That's an exception.
We're going to see in a second. Look at that she over here. V'chiro in dam balayla, ch'ne'emar. Im ashir le'nabal ad ora boker. Mashtin bakir. Shma' mirad avi balayla. Because he said, he's not going to have any remnants by the morning. That means he was judging him already at night. So what does David HaMelech come along and say? Moreh b'malchutu. Hold it. He's a moreh b'malchut, this guy. He's a rebel. He doesn't need to be judged. I don't need to have a court. So therefore, don't tell me a question. He's an exception. He's a moreh b'malchut, and you don't need a court. Amra lo. So she said, wait. Adayin Shaul kayam ve'lo yatz'at tiv'acha ba'olam. It's true. But not everybody knows that you're the king. Your kingdom did not yet become popularized yet because Shaul is still around. And therefore, they don't have emails. They got the email that you're the king. It takes time for the popularity of the king to become known. So you cannot judge Naval as a Moreh b'Malchut if it's not known that you're the Melech yet. So you're judging him prematurely. That's what Abigail is telling.
My look bad.
Azak. Amar la. So listen to what he says. Baruch ta'amech. וברוכה את אשר קליטני היום הזה מבוא בדמי. Bless your reasoning and bless your logic. You saved me from bloods. דמים. דמים. The Gemara says, דמים תרתי משמע. דמים over here is two implications, two interpretations. What does that mean? Number one, you saved me from killing an innocent man. Killing Nabal. Because I would have killed him. That's damim. But there's another damim over here. What other damim, Rabotai? Dam Nida. What is Dam Nida? Now hold on to your seats for a minute here, boys. Don't jump on me yet. Let's read the Gemara. Ela melamed shigilta et shoka. She revealed to David her thigh. Behalach le'ora gimel parsaot. And it was so bright that he traveled three parsaot. and he was attracted to her. Amarla, so David does Abigail, Shmi'ili, marry me, be with me. Amra lo, so she said, oh, slow down. Lo tiye zot lecha lefuka. Here's the proof that she was a prophetess. She says to David, don't let this be a stumbling block. David wanted to be with her. Slow down, Abigail says, don't let this be a stumbling block, implying this will not be a stumbling block, but something else will be a stumbling block. What was the something else that was a stumbling block to David? Bathsheba. Lefuka zot, bichla dika hariti. What's the other item? Umaynihu, maaseh de Bathsheba. As we know. And therefore, what do you see, Rabotai? That Abigail was a prophetess. How did you know about Bathsheba? It didn't happen yet. She says, this, let this not be a stumbling block, because something else will be. And we know at the end, that's what happened. Now, if you look, the Gemara says, look at Rashi on the fourth line. There's going to be a problem. It ended up happened. He did have the issue of Bathsheba. Rabotai, we're not going in today the discussion of David and Bathsheba. We know what the Gemara Shabbat says, Kola Omer David Hata Eno Elotoeh, which means even the Averot of the Tzadikim are not Averot that you think. They're not Averot like we know. These are Devarim She'omdim Berumo Shel Olam. There was one time a big Tzadik that he went to make Tashlich. And he was shaking his jacket and throwing away his sins. The students behind were going like this. They were grabbing. They said, what are you doing? They said, Rabbi, will you throw away for us as a mitzvah? You have a for us as a mitzvot. Yeah, what does the Rav throw away? I didn't have kavanot and rashash when I prayed the Amidah, Hatati. As he prayed the Amidah with all the kavanot of kavanot and rashash. I'll take that one. They're not regular gross sins. But the point is, this Gemara needs to be explained for a second, but let's just finish the point. And then she blessed him that the nefesh of Adoni, my master David, should be bound in the binding of life in the upper worlds. When Abigail was leaving David, she tells him, V'tiv Hashem Adoni, and God will be good to you. Vezachart et amatech. Oh, she says to him, now, listen, don't forget me. Because she knows that something's going to happen to Naval. And now she's going to be a single woman. Therefore, she's telling David, you know, come back. Don't leave me. But she was still married. So the Gemara says, Amar of Nachman, we learned an insight about women from this Gemara. Hainu de Amre Inche. What does it say? A lady can talk and weave at the same time, which means she's still married, but she's already planning the next move. She's already telling David, you know, listen, don't forget me, that she's weaving and talking at the same time. Her mind is already on the next. Ika de Amre, another explanation. Shafir ve'azil bar avza. The bar avza is what? The goose. What is he called? The goose? Or the duck, Hazak Baruch. So Shafir be'azim bar avza. The bar avza, when it walks humbly. But its eyes are up, which means the same thing with Abigail. She's walked humbly, but her eyes are already looking. Ba'den, what's going to be in the future? She's already looking for the next situation. Now, Rabotai, we must read for a moment over here the Maharsha that Chas v'Shalom, she revealed herself. You cannot say that she revealed herself. She's a tzaddikah. She can reveal herself to the tzaddik over here. Hine. Kadva Tosfot. Tosfot comes along and says, look at Tosfot. She gilta shoka. We have Tosfot over here. Kashe akotat tzaddikah gilta shoka lefne David. Impossible. Vod kashe. Temashiki guzma. Vomash alech leor shoka gilta persaot. And what did it mean? Her thigh was so bright that he was able to walk 3 persaot. That sounds like an exaggeration.
Ba leura,
Perush et Abala David Balak Beur Hamimut. Is that what she means? She went not Or. Tosfot changes the Gezat to Ur. What is Ur? The heat. David had Ta'ava. And the Ta'ava is hinted to what as Ur, that he had an inner desire to be with her. Therefore, that desire caused him to walk three parsaot in order to be with her. Now, the Maharsha points out, Velo yadana mi yigid lahem shebedne David ahal shemata elav gata shuka. Velo mashma gen alachum menek bebasaot ava, velo yada bemenu, hu lo yada bemena. Shab gedra elo shemilu alayla aide shekhna shuka menok bebasaot ad shemata elav. Which means you have to say that all of a sudden when she revealed her thigh, some light came. He didn't see the thigh. She was far away. She did not, but she wanted to get David's attention. So when she revealed the thigh, it created a little light. So he said, where is this light coming from? And all of a sudden he had a natural desire because really Abigail was his wife. He would marry Abigail. So therefore it was something that was destined to him. So therefore the not halach le'or, ela le'ur. Ur means the heat, the home, like it says over there in the Gemara. Very good, Rabotai. Now you have to do the Tosafot. The top Tosafot is very important. The top Tosafot over here says, More b'malchut ve'lo tzarich le'midayne. What did David HaMelech tell Abigail? He doesn't have to have a judgment. He said, More b'malchut. And therefore what? We don't have to. What was her claim? And what did David HaMelech say? More b'malchut. There's no judgment on him. Tosafot says, Mechila. There is. Did you forget the Gemara Sanhedrin? When it comes to Dinei Nefashot, capital punishment, we always start with the smallest judge, and then we go from the smallest judge to the biggest judge, because we don't want the biggest judge to give us an opinion. And everybody's going to be scared to open their mouth. So we go to the lowest. And where did we learn that you go from the lowest judge? Midichtiv Gavir Naval. ויחגרו איש חרבו ויחגרו גם דוד חרבו. It says that they started from the other judges, ויחגרו איש חרבו, meaning his claim, and then they gave David. So David was in the court and he went last. So what do you see from this Gemara? There was a court. How did you tell me that Moreh b'Malchut doesn't get a court from David's case of Naval? We learned the laws of court. I thought you don't have to judge him. How could you learn a protocol of court if in the case where you're learning it from, there's no court? That's the sports question. So what do you see in that Gemara Sanhedrin? There is a court. God kashe, each yashav David bedin, v'ayin moshivin melech besanhedrin, kedamnin memasechet sanhedrin. Which means furthermore, how could David sit in the court anyway? The halakha says a king is not allowed to sit in court. What? It was Melech. Lo yatzatim ol ba'olam. But the point is, why can't a king sit in the court? Because not derech eretz. The halakha is like this. The king cannot speak first. Because once the king speaks first, nobody can open their mouth. So therefore, what? The king has to speak at the end. That means he has to be shotek. It's not kavod for the king to sit there listening to everybody else. So they said, since it's not kavod for the king, because he has to be shotek, but over here, it sounds like Sanhedrin that he was sitting on the court. We have a few questions here. Remember the story of Uriah with David? The Gemara says that what did David do? He killed Uriah. So there was a claim for killing Uriah. What was the claim? Not that he wasn't guilty. Uriah was a Moreh b'Malchut. But what was the claim? Why didn't you take him to the Sanhedrin? What do you mean? I thought he's a Moreh b'Malchut. Moreh b'Malchut doesn't need Sanhedrin. Tosfos asking a bunch of questions. Would I understand the question of Tosfos? Question number one is asking, we learned the protocol of Bedin from the story of Naval. Number two, how did David even sit on the court? And number three, why is David punished for not bringing Uriah to Bedin? He shouldn't be punished. Uriah doesn't need Bedin. After all, he's a Moreh b'Malchut. So Sfot comes along and answers very important. Big chiddush. Yesh lomar, de'acha hachi perusho. Moreh b'Malchut hu, ve'lo tzarich le'midinei kish'ar dinei nefashot. Of course he needs judgment, but he's not judged like other capital punishment cases. Let me explain to you. In a normal capital punishment case, let's say the judges on the first day of deliberations say innocent. They all think he's innocent. By the way, they judge innocent. They let him go. But let's say on the first day, they judge him guilty. Halakha says on a regular capital punishment case, they sleep on it. Maybe tomorrow, they'll change their mind. But a Moreh b'Malchut says to Safot, if on the first day the judges say Hayav, they kill him. They don't sleep on it. That's what it means that you don't have to judge him. That they don't have to wait an extra to the morning. Read it inside. ולא צריך למדייני כשאר דיני נפשות שדנים בו ביום לזכות, וביום של החרב לחובה, אלא אפילו בו ביום גומרים לחובה. They finish it לחובה. והיינו עד קרמלי אביגייל, וכי דנים דיני נפשות בלילה, which is, David didn't judge it at night. David had the case during the day. And now what? He was going to kill him. So Abigail comes along and says, wait, you have to wait till tomorrow. David says, no, you don't know the halakha. Moreh b'malchut, you don't have to wait till tomorrow. We can judge him immediately. Which means, to judge him, you can only judge him in the day. But the point is to wait till the next day. That's the claim. But we had a question. Had David seen in the Sanhedrin? So Tosfot answers beautifully. What's the reason why we don't want the king to sit in the Sanhedrin? Because it's not kavod for him. That would have to be quiet when everybody else is talking. But here it is kavod for the king. Why? Because since it's personal, he's a nogeya. So therefore, it's adrabah, it's kavod for him to go last and not for him. Because if he goes first, it looks like he's a nogeya. Hey, you're defending your own kavod. So in a case where it's not disrespectful for the king to be quiet, we let him sit on the court. So he says, they had the end, Moshe Yimelech, but said, they had no mishum, they don't have a kibbo, don't yot yoshev v'shotek. I'm going to go, Goreme Malchut, who yot yoshev v'shotek, levi shonei yeh v'davar. And therefore, it's okay for him to stay there. And therefore, now we understand what the claim of David was against Uriah. He judged Uriah without Sanhedrin. Therefore, you have to judge, even though he's a Goreme Malchut, you have to have a Sanhedrin. So the Maaseh, you need a Sanhedrin, even for Goreme Malchut. The only claim was, that she was saying, you gotta wait till tomorrow. So that David said, no, you don't. And therefore, okay, fine. But lo yatzat tevacha ba'olam. Okay, that's another story. Okay, Rabotai, that's the Tosfot. Very nice. Now we continue and we finish today's Gemara. All right, Rabotai, the Gemara continues. Huldah was a prophet. If you remember the famous Gemara in Pesachim Daftet, over there the Gemara was talking about that if a person makes bidikat hametz, right? So does he have to worry that maybe a hulda, a weasel, will come along and take the, a piece of hametz and bring it to a different place over there? So the Gemara comes along and says in a case where the hulda knows where the hametz is. So the Gemara comes along and says, "Bichi hulda nevi'ah?" The Gemara says it as it's giving a name because Hulda was a prophet. But now the Gemara is referring to the week. It says, Hulda dechtiv, Vayelech Hanqiyahu HaKohen, Vachikam, Ve'achbor, Ve'shafan, Ve'asiyah, El Hulda Nevi'ah. It says Hulda Nevi'ah. Finish. U'bemakom dekae Yirmiyah, Echem etnabiyah ihi. What are you talking about? You had the prophet Yirmiyah. Yirmiyah already was the prophet in the 13th year of the king Yoshiyah. So therefore, you have a prophet. What is she giving prophecy? The official prophet of Klal Yisrael was who? Yirmiyah. So what is Hulda doing? Amre be Rabbi Shimei de Rab, Hulda kerovet Yirmiyah haita v'lo avam makpid aleha. Yirmiyah was a makpid. Hulda was related to Yirmiyah. So Yirmiyah allowed her to give prophecies. He was not a makpid. V'yoshiyah gufeh hechi shavik Yirmiyah mishalei legaba. Wait. But Yoshiyah, you need to know instructions. You have Yirmiyah and Hulda. Why did you go to Hulda, not Yirmiyah? It seemed that Yirmiyah was the more prominent prophet. So why does he leave Yirmiyah and go to Hulda? This is an amazing story. Amri deber Rabbi Shina, b'pnei she'anashim rachmaniyot. Since ladies are rachmaniyot, their prophecies are softer because they pray that the bed should not come. Yirmiyah is takif. So therefore, he wanted to get a good result. So he went to the Oda. Maybe she have a little more Rahmanut. That she says Rahmanut, he doesn't say. But that's the way I explained it. Now why she'll pray so that the Gezerah doesn't come. Rabbi Yochanan Amar, Yirmiyah lo havayata. Another answer. He would have went to Yirmiyah. You know why he didn't go? Why didn't he go? He wasn't there. He was out of town. He was on a business trip. Huh? Tell me what you want. Tell me what you want. What are you doing? What are you doing? We did this already. You want to make Shlomi Kalam HaTargum? We did this already. The Gemara is saying now, the Gemara is saying that Yohanan Amar, Yirmiyah lo havahatam. Yirmiyah wasn't there. Where did he go? Shehalak lehazir aseret ha-shevati. He went on a business trip. Where? To bring back the 10 tribes. The 10 tribes already were sent into exile outside of Eretz Yisrael. So we had to go bring them back. How do we know he brought them back? Stop. We have a law. What happens in the years of Yovel? All properties that were sold go back to the original owner. So and that only applies when the majority of the Jewish people are living in Eretz Yisrael. Understand? So now, Yirmiyah gets up and says, Rabotai, there's going to come a time where when you sell properties, they're not going to return in your veil. That means what? At the time that he was talking, the law did apply. How could the law apply if the 10 tribes were outside? Elah must be from here. He brought the 10 tribes back. So the 10 tribes were back in Israel. The laws of your veil applied, and Yirmiyah was threatening that if you don't behave, there's going to come a time where the laws of your veil are not going to apply. If Shar Yovel batel v'navi mitnabeh alav shi batel, if Yovel didn't exist because the tribes were outside, why does he have to tell us that Yovel is going to be batel? It's batel already. Ela melamed Yirmiyah hazira. Beautifully brought them back. V'Yoshia ben Amon, who was the king over them? Yoshia. Barak aleihem b'chtiv. Ayomer, ma tziyun ala ze shel eni ro'eh. Ayomer olam anshe ha'ir, ha'kever, ish elim asher bam Yehuda. Because Bet-El was where Yerobam was. What is Yoshiah doing in Bet-El? That's Yerobam. That's where the 10 tribes were. Yoshiah is the king of Yehuda. He shouldn't be in Bet-El. Bet-El is where Yerobam and the 10 tribes used to live. And you see, if he was in Bet-El, that means Yoshiah Malach Alehen. He was actually the king over. And he actually says in the sheet that he burnt the bones of the Kumarim of Bet El that Yerobam made. So he did a good job, Yoshia. All those priests that worshipped in Yerobam's Avodah Zarah, Yoshia burnt all those Kumarim, and that's a very, very good thing. Rav Nachman Amar Me'acha, Gam Yehuda Shat Ketzir Lecha Beshumi Shemut Ami. This is referring to Yehuda, which is Yeshia. He was involved in the return, meaning the 10 tribes that returned. Makesh and Yehuda Islam. Ela, you see that Yehuda had a connection with the 10 tribes. Rabotai, we finished today's Gemara. Esther, how do you know Queen Esther was a prophetess? Dikhtiv. Vayi bayom ha-shirishi. Vatilbash Esther Malchut. She wore royalty. Now, you don't wear royalty. You wear clothes of royalty. The Gemara says, "Bekdem malchut mevaid." Ela she lavashta ruach hakodesh. Ela she wore malchut, which is the Shekhinah. The Shekhinah was on her. Ketiva kavet elbash. Ketivata veruach lavasha et amasa irosh shalishim. So that was referring to the wearing of prophecy. Kavet elbash Esther malchut. Amar Rav Nachman, lo yae yehiduta l'neshe. Power is not good for the ladies. When you give a lady power, what happens? Yes. It gets to the head. They become ba'alei ga'ava. Therefore, it's not good. And the Gemara gives two examples of two women that were in power, and they became ge'ot. There were two ladies that they gave them power. V'sanyan shemayu. But look at their names. Their names are bad names. Hada shema ziburta. Who's that? Deborah. Mazet Deborah. A B. Ziburta is a bee. The Hada Shema Karkushta. Mother Karkushta, a weasel. That's Cholda. So you see the names themselves. Amirame, Ze Zibura, Ze Karkushta. Ziburta Ketiba, what does it say? By Devorah. But the Shlach, but the Krale Barak. Barak was a husband. She's a wife. Normally, the wife goes to the husband. Instead, she calls Barak. Yeah, Tala, come over here. She didn't go to him. So they got ahead. Karkashta or Karkushta Ketiba Imrula Ish. She sent message to King Yoshia. What does he send him? Go tell the guy. Two guy. Ish is the king. Velo Amra Imrula Melech. She has to say Melech. What kind of talk is that over there? So the Maharsha says, Afalgab the Senyan Shemayu, even though they had names like that, they should have learned to be humble from their names. Well, that should have learned, if I have a name like this, I better be humble. And Devorah should have learned. Nefishim Otehem, Odaba Devorah Sheferim, Vem no Asukin. Ela Ayu Yehirim, Neged Anashim Ashubim, Kegon Yoshia Ubarak. Very, very good. Very good. I read all you the Maharshas outside, so we're up to date. Let's finish up here. Amar of Nahman, Chuldam, Ibn Ibanab, so Yoshua Haita. Okay. Who is Chulda? She was from the descendants of Yoshua. Ketivacha, Ben, what's that, Lashon?
Harhas.
Harhas. Uchtivatam, Bitimnat Haris. Where was Yoshua buried? In a place called Timnat. Haris, look at Ashi. Ben Harhas, Ma'afagad, Dekra al Ba'ala, Kabasid, Miyu Bema'aseh Akitim. It's talking about Hulda. Even though it was referring to her husband, but it's referring to her too, as she says, therefore she's Harhas. Who's Harhas? The one that's buried in Tamat Haris. Who's one buried in Tamat Haris? Yoshua. So therefore we see that what Hulda is a descendant of Yoshua. Etive Rav'ina Saban Rav Nachman, Shemona Nevi'im. והם כהנים. Seven נביאים. הוא הכהנים יצאו מרחב הזונה. Unbelievable. כמעט מרחב הזונה. ואלוהן. ניריה, ברוך, בסיריה, מחסיה, ירמיה, חנקיה, חנמאל, בשלום. רבי יהודה אומר, אף חודה הנביאה בבני בניה של רחב הזונה הייתה. She also came from רחב הזונה. How do we know? כתיבה, by רחב, what does it say? By חודה, it says, Ben Tikva. It uses the word Tikva. And what does it say by Nahab? Uktivat am et Tikvat Hutashani. So wake up your mind. You're telling me she came from Yoshua. And over here it says that she came from Rahab. How do you square it? Amale Enasaba. Where's it Enasaba? As you explain, Ena Saba. Ena, old man. Because that's the question was from Rav Ena. So it doesn't matter. Ena Saba. The Amri La, Batya Uchma. Batya Uchma meaning the black pottery. I think he was old. He was black like pottery. Minne uminach tistayem shemata. We could learn for both of us, we're both right. I say Yoshua. You say, Nahav. We can combine both of our Devarei Torah and make a new Hiddush. And what are we going to say? Dei Garia. Nahav Azona converted. Benazba Yoshua. I married Yoshua. So therefore, Hulda was actually a descendant from Nahav and Yoshua. You know why? So they were married. Let's just finish it up, Rabotai. The Gemara says, wait. Yoshua didn't have any children. How can you tell me children came from Yoshua? Nun beno, Yoshua beno. Finish. When it's giving the Devarei Yamim, it says Nun was his son, and Nun's son was who? Yoshua. Finish. No more. Et shevet Ephraim has kedub ad Yoshua. It goes up to Yoshua, and from Yoshua there's nobody else. So how can you tell me Hulda came? בינו, בני אלוהווה, לבינתם, אבו לחזק וברוך. He didn't have boys, but he had girls. ברוך אדמה לעולם, אמן ואמן. בי חנניה ברקשה עומד, תסך ברוך ושמי שלפיך,